In this note set, we're going to start looking at chapter 10. In particular, we're going to look at sections 10.1 and 10.2. Both of these sections are pretty short, so this video won't be too long. But in this chapter, we're going to talk about what are called time series. So time series is a collection of data that's been obtained by observing a response variable at periodic points in time. So whenever we have a variable that we measure over time, we call that a time series variable. And we are going to denote it using y sub t. And so the reason for this is this response variable that we're observing, it's going to be a function of time. So that's why we use the subscript t here. And then here we've got some different information about time series. And so when we use time series method, or probably we are going to use time series methods, I should say, when we're confronted with making decisions in which time is an important variable. So in other words, we might be looking at things like finances that we know are going to shift over time. We might be looking at temperature that's going to shift over time. There's all kinds of variables that we know naturally change over time. So considering time is an important thing. Now, most of the time when we collect data for time series, we are going to collect that data at equally spaced or roughly equally spaced intervals, but those intervals could be hourly, daily, monthly, quarterly, annually. It's any time, or pardon me, any type of time points are valid. We just want to make sure we collect it at regular intervals. And then time series are likely to be revealed to us sequentially and only up to the present. So in other words, a lot of times with time series, we're actually going to use them to predict future values. So previously we talked about how we don't want to extrapolate. This is kind of the exception to that rule. In time series, our goal is actually going to be to extrapolate, to look into the future, what's happening. But we're going to have to make sure we do that in a very reasonable way. And so there are some methods to describe the overall pattern in the series. And essentially what time series do is they look at that overall pattern and they predict what's going to happen in the future based off of that pattern, but only for a short time period after we've collected the data. So in other words, we don't want to try to predict really far into the future because we know that those patterns are likely to change. There are other methods to estimate time series that identify structure components like trends and seasonal fluctuations, and we're going to talk about those. And again, the objective of most time series is to provide forecasts of future values. So there's tons of different applications, and I'll let you read those here. And so, for example, here's a plot. This is a time plot of average yield. And so notice down here we have data that's been collected over different years. And the time interval here is 1 year increments, so regularly spaced intervals. And we could talk about, do we see any patterns in this data? So we can see that over time, the average yield seems like it's going down. And then we also see some fluctuations around that overall pattern. And so we're going to look at ways to describe these different types of fluctuations or these different types of changes. All right. So the first thing we have here is what is called the secular trend. That's also known as the long-term trend. It's the steady, gradual change that we see over time, and it's often the most interesting aspect of the time series. Now, if a time series shows no particular trend over time and has a relatively constant mean, it's said to be stationary in the mean. We could talk about seasonal variations. These are rises and falls that always occur at a particular time of year, month, week, or day. And so this pattern is going to occur within year trends, to be repeated from year to year. So for example, from year to year, we know it's hot in the summer and cold in the winter. That wave-like or oscillating a curve occurs within the year and then repeats itself from year to year. And so again, this could be caused by temperature. If we think of holidays, you could think of toy sales, for example. Toy sales get really high around Christmas time and they have a little bit of a lull in the summer. A deseasonalized or seasonally adjusted series is one from which the seasonal component has been removed. And then the time peaks of seasonal components is referred to as the period. We could look at cyclical functions. These are wave-like or oscillating patterns about the secular trend that is attributable to business and economic conditions at the time. It's also known as the business cycle. And cycles in the data may be seen with periods longer than 1 year. So these aren't restricted to be within a single year that repeats itself. Cyclical variations do not follow any definite trend, but move rather unpredictably. We could also talk about residual effect, and so this is the random or upward or downward movement of the series accounting for long-term trend of the cyclical effect and seasonal effect. It's unexplained shifting and bobbing of the series over a short period. And then the residuals of the time series, so that's what this is in terms of what you've seen before with residuals. And our interest in the residual effect component is how variable it is, whether the variability changes over time, whether there are any outliers or spikes that might deserve special attention. And a time series that has a relatively constant variance is said to be stationary. And this can be caused by political events or unpredictable weather. So for example, we're going to see a residual effect when people go back and look at the current data right now because of the coronavirus. There are definitely going to be things when we think about financially that are going to be outliers that are due to this one event, but this isn't something that, you know, hopefully this is a one-time event. You know, we don't keep on seeing this year after year. All right, and then down here at the bottom, we've got some examples. You can actually ignore, sorry, I had to pull an old page of my notes. You can ignore this right here. We're actually going to, this is already on page 4, so just ignore what I've got written here in purple. But we've got three different plots here. So if we look at the first one, the line that we have right here, that is the secular trend. And then we can see the actual data kind of revolves around that overall trend. Here, again, we've got the secular trend. And notice that the cyclical effect also just kind of occurs around it. And then seasonal variation, we see the same high, it goes high and then low, high, low, high, low within the years itself. Here's another plot of how we could view the difference between all of these. So for each of these components, again, we have the secular as the line. The seasonal are those within year variations. The cyclical is this longer variation that occurs around the secular. And then all the little irregular fluctuations, those are the residual effects. So notice that all time series are going to contain the residual component. And then in addition, time series may contain none, one, two, or all three of the other components, trend, seasonal, and cyclical. And so let's look at another example. Notice here we've got a graph of some time series. So what we've got here is we've got different sales over time. Notice if we kind of look at the secular effect, which is the overall trend, it does appear to be rising over time. So that's that secular trend. Looking down here at the x-axis, we've got January, May, and September. Well, January's winter. And then we have early summer and early fall, and then we repeat to January, May, and September. So you can think of here, we start a new year. So notice, right after January, we dip, we go up in May, we continue to go up to September. Dip in January, go up in May, up in September, and more than likely, if we had January data, we would probably dip again some. So there is a seasonal effect here. Now we only have 2 years worth of data, so seeing a cyclical one would be difficult for this plot. All right, so again, just to kind of summarize this section, the objectives of the time series are to identify the components that do exist, and then to identify their causes and to forecast future values. Signal of the time series, those are the long-term or secular trends, cyclical effects, and seasonal effects, and then the noise is that random variation. So the most widely used model for time series is the additive model, and you have that here. And so essentially what this is saying is the response variable at time t is a function of the secular trend component, the cyclical function, or fluctuation rather, the seasonal variation, and the residual effect. And so notice that this is, again, additive, and it might be that some of these effects are zero. So various methods exist for estimating the components of the model and forecasting the time series. They range from descriptive techniques, which rely on smoothing the pattern of the time series, to more complex inferential methods. And we're going to look at some of these as we move through the different sections. And the inferential methods, they combine regression analysis that you've seen before with specialized time series models. So this is going to conclude the section 10.1 and 10.2 video.